Hi, good afternoon, everyone. I'm Ravi Gupta, the CEO Director at Framebox. I welcome you all once again to another session from a masterclass series where you get an opportunity to connect with the industry leaders and professionals. The whole concept of having these live webinars is so that you all can connect with the speakers. So be ready with your questions. We will try to answer most of your relevant questions. Please make sure the questions that you ask are the relevant questions with this webinar. I would like to thank our associate partners, Exposition Pictures, MESC, and Vidyadan for supporting us to bring this webinar to you all. And of course, all our viewers and subscribers, thank you all for your support and participation. Guys, today we are surrounded by technology, graphics, animation, films, games, you know. We use so many tools and we are all learning the same every day. I feel the world today is in a rush to gain technical skills, whereby we are forgetting the importance and the important art behind movie making, which is very, very important. Today's webinar is specifically targeted the lost art of visual storytelling. The webinar will give you an insight on important aspects needed for making short films and writing an engaging script. Who can explain the concept better than the creator himself? Mr. Kabir Khurana. Kabir is one of India's youngest filmmakers. And in a short span of time, Kabir is a 5-time international award winner with short films like Religion for Dummies, Strings, Project Oneness, and many more. He is also the co-founder of India's youngest publishing venture, Bombay Kala Books. So guys, without further ado, let's get Kabir to share his experience and knowledge with all of us.
Hi Ravi, thank you for the introduction.
Thank you so much, Kabir. Hi, how are you? I hope all good.
Yeah, all good. It's just the lockdown and it's got to everyone.
But the good part is these webinars bring so much of insight which was not happening through the COVID season. So hopefully this is something that we take away as a positive from the COVID.
Absolutely.
So Kabir, can you share a bit about your career path and what interested you to get into making films?
I actually started making films at about 6 or 7. I started with these short 10 to 15 second long animation films, and they were entirely hand-drawn, frame by frame. And obviously compiled them together and then you play it back, obviously it's an animation film. So I started off like that. And I was, about, I think 6, 7 or 8, I don't know, I was really young. And then obviously moved on to, in school, I started a small society called Film Zone. I remember what we used to do is we used to make these film strips, and we used to make panels and we used to sketch on these panels. And we used to play it behind, these water bottles filled with water. So the image used to magnify, and we used to charge like a rupee for every screening. So that's how it started, really. That's how my interest started. But I really loved telling stories, and I love telling stories visually. So I used to also make a lot of comic strips, a lot of comic books. And I think I made my first professional film when I was about 16. It was a film called Project Oneness that I shot with one of my photography coaches. His name was Sanjeev Walsan. He had shot for Times of India and Lonely Planet. He was a photographer primarily, not shot a film before. So we went out on 2 weekends and we shot this short 5-minute long nugget. And that film went on to win several accolades internationally. And that actually motivated me to go ahead and make filmmaking my professional career. That's how it started. Wow. And then, subsequently, I made a film called Ism. And then I made Strings, Religion for Dummies, Karma Cafe, so on and so forth.
Wow. So at an age where kids are just looking at, having fun, frolic, and not unsure about what they want to do with their life, you've already established such a beautiful career path for yourself. I mean, it's so, so good to know that such a young age, you've achieved so much, so Kabir, you've also studied method acting. So can you share a little insight on it?
Well, I studied method acting purely from a direction standpoint. I wanted to know how to kind of give instructions to actors in a way that, you know, you can actually extract the right performances as per what you're really visualizing, right? So I studied method acting at the Jeff Goldberg studio. Now, Jeff Goldberg has his own kind of method. He doesn't really follow the Stanislavski system or the Meisner technique. He follows an amalgamation of the two, which is, I think it's called the Goldberg technique, if I'm not mistaken. So he's a very good coach. You know, he teaches us grounding. He teaches us a kind of, there are a lot of meditative practices that he does, a lot of connecting with your inner life, you know, really looking at the pit of your stomach and really connecting with yourself and kind of learning how to internalize the character, learning how to actually get into the skin of the character and act and react accordingly. So I really learned a lot from that.
And how did your history study at Ashoka University help you with filmmaking?
Well, that's a complicated question, because I personally believe, and this is my personal philosophy, that all art is political, all good art is political at least. And when I mean political, I mean the politics that play out at different levels, you know, the politics that plays out at an international level, national level, state level, local level, and obviously a home level, right? Now, as we know, history, the past and history really affects the politics of the present, right? And therefore, you know, to be responsible citizens, and in order to be aware of, you know, politically aware and to take the right kind of stand, one must know his or her own history extremely well, right? And the point of, and connecting this obviously to cinema, the point of cinema is not only entertainment. It is obviously to drive home a point, just to drive home a message. And therefore, you know, being politically aware is extremely important to shape you into a sensible filmmaker. So that is primarily why I studied history. And I sometimes wonder, you know, why we don't learn from the past. Because the past teaches us so many lessons, you know, that we should ideally learn from. And that's the reason why I've learned history, to kind of incorporate the past and to teach the, to kind of, I don't want my films only to be entertainment. I want them to be informative also, in a way.
That's absolutely one of the most important aspects, I feel, of filmmaking. So, Kabir, you have also won so many national and international awards, including the Global University Film Award, which is, you know, known as the Student Oscar in Hong Kong. You know, this entire journey of winning so many awards with all your successful films, can you share with our audience the journey and your experience?
Well, the objective was never to win awards, very frankly. The objective was to, you know, tell personal stories. That was always the objective. The objective was always to tell personal stories. The objective was always to have fun while making your films. So, of course, there was initial excitement when the first few of my films did win awards and, you know, went and internationally and was screened at several places. But now, obviously, it's become such a regular kind of occurrence in the past few years that now it's no more exciting. You know, now I want to push the bar and do something different. So, I'm not trying to really please any programmers at any festivals anymore. Now I'm trying to please myself, and that is the most difficult task.
Well, you've been really modest, because your films have been screened in Italy, US, Ukraine, Brazil, Prague, Singapore, Indonesia, Morocco, Croatia. I mean, I don't know, your films have been screened practically everywhere. So that's really nice to see you being so modest about it. But then, you know, let's give the audience a little insight about the work that you've done. So let's start off with your first project, the Project Oneness in 2015. I think that was your first project. So before we get to know more into it, can we have a small presentation about the film, please? Wow, that was such a strong message that you brought out through this movie. I mean, I can just understand I was so enthralled in watching just the small clipping of it. I can understand how beautiful this entire film was made. And you made it in 2015 when you were just a teenager. So how did you think of coming up with this kind of a concept, and what was it that got you to make this film?
So it was co-conceptualized with a friend of mine, a school friend of mine. And the idea was, I remember we were sitting at Starbucks and we were just jamming. And the idea was to make a film on unity and diversity. And we realized that the common thread that connects people across strata of society and across the board is the fact that human emotions stay the same, right? Even if you're, it doesn't matter if you're Ambani or if you're, you know, from your auto rickshaw wala, you'll still be as anxious about your son's or daughter's exams, or you know, you all human beings have common emotions, you know, of fear, love, anxiety, guilt. You know, relief. I don't know. I mean, human emotions stay constant across the board, and that's what really connects all of us as human beings. And therefore, why the hell do we create these divisions? That was the whole concept. It was a very simple idea actually that we executed.
But it was really executed so well. Let's show the audience even another film which was even better. That's your film Religion of for Dummies. That was in 2018. So let us show that film to the audience as well. how? I saw a lot of stop motion in the film. So can you give some insight? I mean, what is the stop motion all about?
So this is not really stop motion. This is pixelation, which is, of course, a form of stop motion, but except stop motion is usually with inanimate objects. This is obviously with the live character, performer. We basically shot this over a span of 8 days. We had about 7,000 frames that we shot. And obviously, because the walls, as you can see behind, are being hand-painted, we had to wait for about 5 to 10 minutes before painting the new on the wall behind before taking the next shot, right? So it took this much time to, shoot the entire thing. It took about 8 days to shoot the entire thing. And a lot of pre-production, a lot of planning went into it, about, I think, a month, month and a half, just planning went into it, because we had some test shoots that we did. And we also knew that, once the character moves from point A to point B, in that those many number of frames, that whole mural behind should get completed. And obviously, the mural behind was reflective of the characters in a monologue. So it's also a metaphor. Each mural is also a metaphor in a way. I think there are 8 or 9 murals behind that are being completed in whole. It did take some time to do this film. It took me about 6 months to complete the whole film, because even in the edit, we knew that, some places I wanted pauses. And then the whole music, to get that right, to get the sound design right. And obviously, to put the whole film together took half a year almost. And it's only about three and a half minutes long.
So once again, using a little different technique in your filmmaking, but you get the message out very strongly, which is very important. So moving forward to another film that just came up last year, that's Karma Cafe 2019. Now, that movie was named one of the top 15 Indian short films by Candid Tech, and amongst the top 87 short films are web shorts. That's definitely exciting. So let's have a trailer of that film. Let's show it to the audience as well.
Is this place open?
Yes, it is. Unlike your mind.
Why are there no prices?
Well, things don't work that way. Most people lack the courage to face the consequences of their actions.
Are you sure this is what I ordered?
No, it isn't.
And where's my Turkish red lentil soup?
You don't deserve it, I guess. The truth will set you free. This is Cafe Karma. You get what you deserve.
So I guess we had a little bit of difficulty over there. So coming next to your current project, that's Hangout. I think that film is being executed remotely. How are you doing that?
That film was actually shot remotely about, I think, a month ago. So we had this, this live feedback that I was getting on my laptop. And we had three people on set, one recordist, one associate director, and one cinematographer. And obviously, I was getting the live camera feedback. So whatever the camera was seeing is an output I was getting directly on my laptop. So I was able to give directions on performances and, composition, general lighting, and all of that. It was quite a unique experience because I didn't know something like this was possible. But, this, like you said in the beginning, very rightly so, this pandemic in a way has made people more explorative, and it's made people more efficient. And, it's introduced new technology into the whole game. So I think it was just a wonderful experience, shooting the film.
I think coming next to one of your favorite films, I think that's Dali. So can we have a look at the promo of Dali? You spent 8 months creating the film, which was entirely on chroma with very high use of VFX.
Absolutely.
religion. इसके बाद
बस नेमो टू मी
Wow, in a closed room just with chroma and some high-end VFX, you really got wonders out of it. I heard you used a lot of concept on anamorphic sculpture. Can you please share what is that about?
So anamorphic sculptures are basically, these wire frames that are placed at, at different levels in a kind of a spatial distance. And you know, when you only when you look at it from a certain point does the entire image make sense and actually look like some form, right? But if you actually look at it from the side or you look at it from any other angle, it is formless. So that is what anamorphic sculptures are actually. So basically, that's what we used in this. It's only when the camera tracks to the final point that you can actually see these brush strokes making this beautiful piece of Dali artwork. But you know, when they're painting it at different levels, like I said. In abstract space, they don't make any sense, you know, as an image, as a complete whole image. So those are
I have to,
if you want to see a best example is at the Nehru Science Center, you know.
Okay.
That's only when you stand at one point do you see the entire image because you have these different blocks that are placed at different distances.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay, that's nice. So for the audience, we have a wonderful presentation that Kabir would like to share. From one of his films, Religion for Dummies, which he released in 2018. Kabir would take you through the entire process of Religion for Dummies.
Yeah, you can move next. Yeah, next. So we're basically going through the making of Religion for Dummies. Since this is one of the most ambitious projects I've done, I mean, in terms of experimenting with a new kind of format or new kind of style. So I think it was a very painstaking task to kind of paint those walls, those murals behind frame by frame, and kind of shoot these 7,000 frames and put them together. Which is why I thought it would be interesting to go through the making of the film. You can go next. Yeah, so this was, I think this was 2017 when we actually shot the film. So this was 10 June 2017. This is how the scheduling was done. So I just put together this entire slideshow to take you through the entire journey of making the whole film. You can move next. Yeah, so this was one of the first few meetings we had. We had Ranjit Daya from the Bollywood Art Project. He's known for Asia's largest murals, the Dada Saheb Phalke one, which is next to the Bandra Worli Sea Link, and obviously the big Amitabh Bachchan one as well, and then several others on Chapel Road. So he came on board to, help us with painting the murals and, creating the film. And this was one of the first color palettes that we discussed for the film. So we primarily wanted, I think, pastel colors and less saturation. That is what we had discussed, I think, in the first, but then again, everything was flipped around. You can move next. So we had two primary references. One was a Pramod Pathy film called Abid from 1974, and another was Norman McLaren's Neighbors, which is an Oscar-winning film. Right. And you can move next. Yeah, this was some of the art and costume references and some of the sketches that we did done at that time, some of the concept art. So this was some of the sketches that, in fact, I had made. These were, some references for the glasses that you saw in the film, which we wanted to actually make. Yeah. Next. Yeah, this was some of the concept art. This was some of the first concept art, to yeah, you can move next. Again, we knew that the religious symbol that we use cannot have connotations to any specific religion, yet needs to have that kind of religious vibe to it. So we thought that the best would be, you know, an eyeball or an eye. But then, you know, after that, since that whole fidget spinner was a fad at the time, we changed it to a fidget spinner. Yeah, you can move next. This was some of the storyboarding that we did. We were, you know, going in all directions, you know, really stretching our imagination and seeing what we could do. Of course, a lot of these things that we sketched out in the beginning, we knew was not going to be easy to achieve. So we scrapped a lot of it. But finally, I think the film, visually at least, it had a lot of elements and a lot of glimpses of what we actually worked on in the beginning itself. Yeah, next. Yeah, again, some more of the concept art and storyboarding, some notes that we had sketched. Next. Yeah, some more, you know, notes and close-up shots and how they will look and how he, you know, basically the protagonist will point and the poster will magically appear. So some of those sketches that you can see on the right-hand side. And again, some more sketches of the religious symbol on the left. Next. Next. Yeah. Next. Yeah, this is, you know, we were just putting some more order to the chaos. So after feedback, you know, the storyboard actually started to take some form. Some concrete form and start to look like something we could see visually. Next.
This looks like your master sheet, your daily routine workings. So I think Kabir just has some connectivity issue. He's back. So Kabir, this looks like your daily schedule of targets that you want to complete on a particular day.
Can you see me?
Yeah.
Yeah. So this was, of course, the master breakdown that we did. Yeah, you can move next. And requirement list that we prepared. Next. So we had several months of conceptualization, pre-production, several days of shoot, several visual designers, artists working on the visualization of the film, and about 7,000 plus hand-painted frames put together to create this 3-minute long satirical short film. Next.
So this is on shot location.
Ravi, can you see me now? Sorry.
I can see you. Yes.
Okay. I think I lost you for a bit.
Yeah, that was for us. That's okay.
Yeah, so this was, of course, these were some of the screenings. You can move next, you can move faster. You can move faster, you can just go through the rest. Yeah, these are some of the screenings, some of the festivals we went to, we, you know, the film went to. Yeah, next. Next. This is Mr. Abid Surti. You know, he saw the film and he really loved it. And of course, our film was inspired by his 1974 film, Abid, which was directed by Pramod Pathy. And he's a very well-known visual artist. And the whole film was done in the style of his work, which actually inspired our film. Next. Next.
So definitely feels nice, you know, to be appreciated by the person whose work is being followed.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. So just for my general audience, for your information, Kabir is not just working on his own films. Kabir is also being part of directing his, you know, he's also assisted Zoya Akhtar for the Ghost series for Netflix. Kabir has also assisted Kirit Khurana for T for Taj Mahal. So besides being busy with shooting and doing his own film, Kabir has also been associated and helping other directors to work on their films as well. So Kabir, can you tell us your views about scripting and conceptualization? How does one start if he's really interested in it?
So, well, there's no one particular method, really. I personally draw from my own personal experiences or, you know, philosophical concepts that I'm usually mulling over or even social issues that are relevant to the times. So, as you know, Project Oneness was a film on unity and diversity. Ism was a film on ideological commitments and freedom from the trappings of ideology, which was, again, inspired by the ideas of Jay Krishnamurti. Strings was, since I'm an aficionado of music, I'm very, very passionate about all, you know, about world music and, you know, picking up rare music from, and listening to rare music from different parts of the world. Strings was actually inspired by La La Land. So it was a film about finding music. You know, it was supposed to be this kind of lyrical poetry in motion. Religion for Dummies, of course, was this satirical mockumentary on, you know, these farcical godmen, you know, and I drew inspiration from, you know, Radhe Ma and Gurmeet Ram Rahim Singh, whatever.
Oh, wow.
I mean, you can see in the kind of exuberant costumes he's wearing and the kind of extravagance that, you know, he's,
right.
This godman has in the film. It was obviously inspired by Ram Rahim. Karma Cafe, again, is on ideas of, Reformation and repentance, and Dali was inspired by, you know, Pas de Deux, which is Norman McLaren's film, and a film called Choros by Michael Langley. So I each of my films are, I'm quite genre agnostic, right? Each of my films are, I've experimented and, you know, played with a different genre. And really, I don't have any one particular way of conceptualizing. I usually get an epiphany and I get an idea, and then I just go ahead and just write it that very day, and I go ahead and shoot it. So that's my process. I just enjoy making the film, and that is it. That's what I said. There's no one way of going about it. It's just that one kind of epiphany that you get, and you go and you grab it. And that very moment itself, you should seize the day. You should seize that opportunity. Go ahead and write it. And go ahead and shoot it without thinking twice.
That's such a good message that you brought us to our audience, that it's not, you know, to sit down on a table and with a paper and pen and jot down a script. Script basically comes in with your travel, with your experience. It's whatever you like is a script. So as long as you have a good script, you conceptualize what your experience takes you with that script. So that's a very important message that you shared with us.
Absolutely. I'm sure. You're a keen observer of life, and you need to absorb, you know, experiences from the world around you.
Absolutely. In fact, I do see a lot of questions coming in, you know, from our audience, from whatever they've heard and, you know, seen so far. So let's have a small session to answer some questions. Can we get some questions for Kabir? So we have a question from Abhishek Chauhan. How did the music come so correct? That's a very good question. How do you visualize it?
for Religion for Dummies?
I guess it would be, I mean, you could take it for whichever movie.
So I actually think in music, right? There's this quote by Stanley Kubrick, says that cinema should be more like music, you know, more like music than a piece of writing. It should be, a film must touch, move and inspire. That's the whole idea, right? And since I think in music, even when I'm working on the edit, I'm always cutting my film to a reference track. And then obviously that reference track becomes inspiration for my composer, you know, to kind of find the right tempo, to find the right melody, to find the right refrains. That's how we get the music right. I think the only thing that I get right in every film is in fact the music. I don't think I do a good job in any other department, very honestly.
So it surely shows you another passion of music as well.
Yeah, incredible passion for music. In fact, I've learned more from more about cinema from music than from watching films.
Wow, that's interesting.
I'm just, you know, many days I just put on my headphones, and you know, my friends know this. In fact, they you know, they keep telling me, Mr. Kabir, you always have your headphones on. Even now, I'm just have these headphones on. I'm always listening to music wherever I go. I'm just listening to some instrumentals, and I'm walking, and I'm just observing life. I'm just feeling the surge of emotions. So that's my way of being.
So I'm sure the audience would like to know, is there some specific music that you're fond of? You're fond of any music that's good?
Mostly instrumentals, mostly film scores. So I listen to a lot of film scores. I listen to a lot of instrumentals. I listen to a lot of world music from different parts of the world. I listen to a lot of jazz, a lot of rock. Yeah, that's about it. A lot of blues.
I think that should have answered the question. Do we have the next question for Kabir? It's again from Abhishek Chauhan. Do you also do script writing?
Well, in fact, a lot of filmmakers cannot make films unless the scripts are written by them. I'm one of those kinds. You know, I can't direct a film if it's not come from me. At least the core idea should have come from me, you know, for me to go ahead and actually feel for that film and go ahead and make it. Because a filmmaker must internalize his or her own work. Otherwise, how do you feel every shot? How do you put these shots together, and how do you really feel for the film? You don't. It's not personal then for you. It's just a product. It's not a film.
So true. So true. Next question. This is from Surat Sapkar. Are you making or working on any movie right now? That's obviously something that we would also like to know.
I run a production house called Exposition Pictures. So obviously we're pitching, but you know that the downturn that this whole pandemic has brought in, economic downturn, has led to a lot of potential plans slashing their budgets, right? And therefore now we're in a pitching stage. But of course we're developing a web series at the moment. I'm working on a web series that I'm developing, and I just finished a film, the post-production for a film, in fact, day before yesterday. It's a film called Hangout, which I think we already spoke about.
Yeah, we did.
So yeah, I've been working and pitching and you know, doing a lot of outreach work at this point. And like I said, I just finished a film 2 days ago.
So before we move on to the next questions, Kabir, I would like to continue with certain questions that I have for you. And this is one of the questions that, you know, at our education vertical, we get it from each and every student, you know. They always want to know, why is pre-production important for making a film? This is a very important question for us as well.
Well, in fact, for me, I think I make the film in pre-production. I don't do anything on set except for give instructions to actors and direct actors and performances. I don't look into any other department, that is production design, lighting, cinematography. I work on all those aspects of filmmaking, and I give my instructions and my directions on all the other other fronts in the pre-production stage itself. So I write a lot of treatment notes. I work and I put a lot of planning, you know, into my films. I do a lot of storyboarding, blocking, pre-visualization, concept art, animatics. Take out music references, take out lighting references, work on my cinematography treatment notes, scheduling, master breakdowns, property lists, casting and auditions, references, you know, take out a lot of references for the style of the film that I'm trying to make.
It sounds like a 10% job being done by one, but then that's what is needed to really get a successful
I do several location recce's for each of my films because locations become again important. So I do a lot of pre-production. I pick my team very carefully. I'm very particular about the wavelength of all the people I get on board. It has to really match mine, and they really must be able to see the film the way I do.
Just to tell my audience that pre-production forms the backbone of making your film. So pre-production is right, your film goes really highways, Also, Kabir, as a director, what is the level of production work required and how do you manage it?
So, see, earlier I used to do a lot of production work myself because I didn't have budgets and I didn't have a team. So I learned a lot of, production myself just by doing it on the job, I used to be coordinating with the light wala, the camera vendors, making the call sheets myself, calling the actors myself, even going to the extent of, making the props myself. For example, I made those hats myself. Like I literally sat in the night and I glued those hats together and, even the stickers and all, I remember I got them printed. So all that stuff, I've gone through that process and that rigor of doing the production work myself. But now of late, I have a line producer or I have an EP who does the production for me. So I just look at the creative aspect of things. I just put the mind and the brain behind the project, but I don't really go on ground myself and, get into the nitty gritties of it.
Right. Okay.
So, for all
my audience, Kabir has really learned it the hard way. Now he is reaping the fruits of it. But then everyone needs to go and learn the things the right way. That's a very important message. Kabir, you spoke about your passion for music, your passion for sound. I would like to understand, how do you manage to, sync the entire sound and your music with your visuals? I mean, because it's always difficult to, have your sound and visualize at the time of shoot. How do you manage to do it?
So as an exercise, what I tend to do a lot is in the night, sometimes I just put on my headphones and I'm just listening to a beautiful piece of music and I kind of visualize, I just let myself free, and let my imagination free. And I just, kind of see this whole imagery come to life in my mind's eye. And a lot of those things that I see, all of those images that come, to me, are the images that I finally use and the kind of shots that I take in the film. Right?
Okay.
So I actually think in music. A lot of times what happens is I get my ideas from music and I get my whole visualization from music.
Wow,
it comes to me naturally when I'm listening to a piece of music that is emotional or that is heartrending. Or heart-wrenching, and it just comes to me, and this whole landscape and this whole imagery comes to me when I'm listening to a piece of music.
I'm sure a lot of audience would have this question, which even I have. I mean, after you make a short film, how do you go about distributing it? How do you market your film? How do you get it to these levels?
This is a tough.
There's also the same question from Sunny and Vinayak. So we share the same question.
Okay. Cool. So this is a tough question for short films. Unfortunately, short films don't have a market at this point. But there are a couple of platforms that produce and distribute short films. One is of course Hamara Movie. They have distributed 3 of my short films. There's of course Shorts TV. There's Large Short Films. There's Terribly Tiny Tales. There are a bunch of others. I think there's also Hotstar that is now distributing short films. We have just got into it, I think 1.5 months ago. Woot is distributing short films. There's also Pocket Films. These are the ones I know. And so these are the ones I can speak about. You can't really, at this point, to profit from a short film is very hard, because short films really don't have a market at this point.
So
getting funding for the cost of production itself is hard. When people usually produce short films, they usually a short film is usually your visiting card. It just goes into your portfolio. So people just they don't usually pay the director or the crew. They just pay for the production, and that's about it.
And how do you cast your actors, and what do you actor, what do you look into an actor before you casting them? This is another question from Mr. Kunal Chopra. He's asking this question: how do you cast actors, and what do you look in an actor?
What do I look for in an actor? Well, how do I cast actors? Okay, so I cast. I think that the most important thing that I have learned, from that short stint that I did and that short course that I did at Jeff Goldberg, is that actors must train, right? So how do I cast actors? I usually cast actors who are trained actors. It's not to say that there are no untrained actors who are extremely competent. Of course there are, but I prefer to, cast people whom I know who've gone through that rigor and gone through that training. And yes, of course, I cast also as per, the character that I visualized. And I cast as, there are a lot of paradigms, a lot of parameters according to which I cast my actors. I do a lot of auditions, and on that basis, obviously, I select who my cast is going to be.
Can you also share with the audience the process of how these short films, make it to the award functions, they make it to the international market? What is the process? How do they manage to reach there?
So there are a couple of portals. There's a portal called Film Freeway, right? And there's also a portal called Without a Box. So you basically upload your film up on those portals, and then you can select which festivals you want to send it to, and they automatically send it. And then you send them a follow-up email with the link to the film, and and then if your film is selected, then they will notify you.
And these information would be available on the site, or is it available? Where are these information available?
The information on festival submissions.
Yeah,
it's all there. It's very intuitive, the website. You can just have a look. You open the website, and that itself, the website itself takes you through the entire process. So it's not very difficult to figure out.
Just to also add a few more feathers to Kabir's cap, I would also like to tell my audience that Kabir has featured in many, 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 publications. He's featured in The Hindu, The Scroll, TOI, Film Companion, Bombay Review, Mumbai Mirror. These are just a few to name, for his work in social entrepreneurship and filmmaking. Kabir has been covered widely by the publications. He's supposed to be the blue eye boy for the publications when it comes to this segment. Vishal, do we have more questions for Kabir? There's a question from Jax Johnson. How important do you think are short films for a person venturing into direction?
I think very important. I don't think anybody will give you a feature or even an ad film if you've not made a short film to prove your competence.
Okay.
So I think the only way to get into direction is to go ahead and make your first film, your first short film. I think that's the first step.
Okay. That's nice. That's good to know. We have a question from Devesh Parab. How you got Mr. Amol Gupta on board for your film Karma Cafe, and where can we watch it?
Okay, so the I'll answer the second part first. It's on YouTube. You can go watch it. It's on the Amara Movie channel. You can go ahead and watch it there. And how did I get Amol Gupta on board for the film? So this is interesting. My grandfather had made a film called Garonda.
Right. You've seen that.
And in that film, there's a song called Ek Akela Hai Shahar Mein, which was written by Gulzar, right? And in that, there's one line, which is Jab Tare Zameen Par Girte Hai something. And jo Tare Zameen Par ka jo wo line hai, is what, Amol Gupta used to title his maiden film, Tare Zameen Par.
Okay, right.
So Tare Zameen Par, the title Tare Zameen Par actually comes from that, the lyrics of the song from my grandfather's film. And so I've known Amol Gupta since my childhood, in fact. When I wanted to make the film, obviously, we reached out to Nasir. And I think he gave us a date of November or something like that. And he was not available at the time. So then I called up Amol Gupta and I asked him to on board the project, and he was really nice, you know, about it. And he just called me to his office and he said, pitch me the idea. And I went ahead, pitched it, and he liked it, so he came on board.
Wow, that's nice. So we also got to know how the name Tahir Zameen Par came in for the movie.
Yeah.
We have a question from Subhay Satta. How do you do shooting for short films, indoor or outdoor, depending on the scenario?
Right. So, I try to mix it up. I feel like if it becomes too much of a chamber drama, which is that it's entirely set indoors, then it can get a tad bit monotonous, and therefore you want to see the outer world. And of course, shooting outdoors is not as easy because you have less control, right, on the lighting, on the sound, on several other fronts, you know, permissions, all those kinds of things. So shooting outdoors is usually shooting guerrilla. And, you know, I try and obviously not have any shots which are talky shots or shots that I require sound for, you know, when I'm shooting outdoors. And I keep all the shots where there are dialogues, I keep those for the indoors. So that's how I do it.
That's nice. We have another question coming from Sohan Kundu. Do you follow Dan Harmon's story circle in order to frame your story? That's a nice question.
I do follow Dan Harmon's story circle. But I don't just follow, of course, Dan Harmon's technique is just one. There's also Robert McKee's story where he talks about, of course, telling dramatic stories and, you know, screenplay writing. And there's also, obviously, everybody knows Sid Field's screenplay, which again is on creating conflicts, conflict points and resolutions and, you know, telling a dramatic story. So there were several, everybody has their own methods, actually. But I think Dan Harmon's story circle is very short and concise and very, very simple to follow. So yes, I have.
Before we move to the next question, I have a question for you, Kabir. Besides doing your filmmaking and all that, you're also doing part-time graphic designing, illustration and writing. So how do you manage, you know, to do all these things together?
Well, what is filmmaking? Filmmaking is a culmination of being able to write, being able to visualize, which is, again, your ability to, and obviously storyboarding involves some amount of sketching and illustration. It involves a musical understanding. It involves a whole range of different kinds of skill sets.
Right.
And only when you can get an all-round understanding of the entire creative arts in general, can you be a filmmaker. Right. So I don't think this is any separate from what I'm really doing. I have always loved to draw. I've always loved to sketch. Like I said, I used to make a lot of comic strips when I was younger. So I do a lot of illustration work. Yes, I do write a lot as well. Apart from, of course, writing my scripts, I write a lot of essays, some amount of poetry as well. So that is something that I do. And graphic design, of course, because I am so used to doing, you know, designing the posters for my films myself. I kind of learned graphic designing on my own, you know, Photoshop, Illustrator. Just by, you know, doing some design work, you know, to create graphics and creatives and posters for my films.
That's good to know.
That's how I did it, yeah.
So we also have one question coming in from one of our viewers. Vishal, can we get the question? It's again from Jack Johnson. In your opinion, what is the difference between short film and a full-length one?
Well, short films are a little trickier to tell because, you know, you nearly need to, in that span of 10 minutes or whatever you choose the length of your film to be, you need to set up your character, set up your environment, create that world, tell your story, have a conflict point and have a resolution. So you have lesser time to keep your audience engaged, yet you have lesser time to actually set up the world and set up your characters. So I think that's the primary difference, right? With a feature film, you know, you can take a little space, you know, a little breather. You can take 10 minutes, 15 minutes, but you know, to set up your character. But with a short film, that is basically the length of your film. So you need to do whatever you need to do in that time. So it gets a little trickier.
We have one more question coming in from Harshu Jain. So how do you think extraordinary content, something like different? So he's asking you, how do you think of a extraordinary content?
Well, I don't think anybody has an answer to this, but I would say that I don't think you should think of extraordinary content. You should think of ordinary content. And the reason I say this is because the best piece of advice I have personally received from, in fact, Mr. Saeed Mirza, is that he says, "Tumhari film se badbu aani chahiye. Your film should smell of the earth, right? And it should have, it should, for the audience to connect to your film, they must relate to it, and it must seem convincing. And therefore, it must be ordinary, right? It should be about ordinary people. It should be about ordinary emotions, and it should be about life as we see it." Right, so don't think of extraordinary ideas. Don't even go in that direction. Think of the ordinary. Think about the world. Think of the world around you, and the world around you is very ordinary. So just reflect on that, and create accordingly.
Thank you so much. So we have another question from Jack Johnson. He really is following you very closely. What, according to you, should be strategies to attain mass marker acceptance, viewership for short films?
Again, I can't answer this question. I don't think this should even, I don't think this thought should even cross your mind, very honestly. You should tell the story you want to tell and forget the rest. Frankly, that's what your approach should be. And I mean, frankly, who knows, what works? Really, nobody has an answer to this. Sometimes, things that you wouldn't expect to do well at the box office does extremely well. And sometimes things that, you think will be a 100 crore grosser does extremely poorly. So really nobody has an answer to this.
Right. I think we have one last question. That's from Devesh Parab. How was your experience working with Zoya Akhtar for the film Ghost Stories?
Well, I learned a lot from that experience. I was there only for a few days. I was there for the entire shoot, but since it was a short film, we shot it in about 10 days, 11 days. I think it was incredible because I picked up a lot of things from her. I realized that, one of the techniques she uses, which is very similar to even what Satyajit Ray, in fact, used to do. He used to go close to the actor and give instructions so that the whole unit or the whole crew is not aware of what directions he was giving to his performers. And that is something that even Zoya was following as a method.
Right.
And I feel like that's a better way of going. And, when with actors, they're... good actors are very sensitive human beings. So I realized, she would first praise them, first commend them on what she liked, and then critique them on what she didn't like and what she'd like them to change. So that was one approach that I found interesting. And apart from that, of course, composition-wise, she used to see some negative space. She used to say, "Acha, wahan pe painting laga do, ya wahan pe foregrounding chahiye mujhe, ya wahan pe kuch wo thoda khali lag raha, to wahan pe kuch laga do, kuch filler dal do." So things like that, which I kind of picked up on.
Great. So I really feel this session was so insightful. I mean, the kind of experience and the journey that you've shared with us, the work that we've seen coming out from you, the experience that you've shared with our audience, I'm sure it's so informative that it's definitely going to help our audience to, put it into their short films whenever they make. I once again, on behalf of Framebox Kabir, thank you so much for getting this time out, sharing your experience with our lovely audience. Just one last thing for the audience, we keep bringing in these webinars. So the ones who have not subscribed, please do subscribe to the channel and do click on the bell icon so that you get regular updates about the future webinars coming up. So Kabir, on behalf of everyone, on behalf of Team Framebox, I really thank you for your time and all this beautiful insight that you've given us. It was lovely knowing all of this. Thank you so much, Kabir.
Thank you. Thank you for having me. Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you.